Ladies and gentlemen, let's go. Level up. Lifestyle. Level up. Wellness. Level up. Level up. Damn good time. Level up. Level up. Level up. Level up. Level up. Ladies and gentlemen, let's go. Hit it.
To the Holistic Life Podcast, presented by Say What Radio.
And we are live.
What up? Welcome to the Holistic Life Podcast. I'm Jenny.
I'm Jay.
And we are in the Coping with COVID series. And we have a special guest today for you. I was waiting for Jay to say something else.
No, you got it. Go ahead.
Yo. So we have one of our really good friends, Stephanie Sikora. She's a professional organizer, life system specialist, and she is a wizard when it comes to getting control of your life inside of your house and everything around that. So she is here with us today, and we're just going to have a chat about everybody being homebound a little bit more right now and how we can use some of her tips and tricks to maybe organize some of the chaos we have inside of our homes, which I'm sure is a little bit more. Welcome, Stephanie.
Thank you, guys. So good to be here and to chat with you. I miss you guys.
Yay. We actually said like last week when all this dies down, we're coming to Colorado.
Surprise.
To hang out and visit with you guys.
Yes.
As long as it's not too cold.
No. Well, I don't think it's cold, but compared to Florida, it's probably cold. But I grew up in upstate New York, so I think it's always warm and sunny here. So.
Just no snow. We'll come in July when there's like all the wildflowers. Actually, we probably miss it, the wildflower season.
You have to head to the mountains for that. But yeah, we'll coordinate it just right for you.
Sweet.
So I don't know, just mention a little bit more about what you do. I mean, I think you're a wizard, but what does a wizard do in organizing?
I love that you shop at my favorite store, the Container Store.
Oh my God, that's so funny. Yes. So well, I like that. I like being called the wizard. That's what we'll do, Jay. When you come visit, we'll go tour the Container Store together. Yes. So interesting, people always ask what I do and how I started. And since we are talking about coping with COVID, I actually was in healthcare for 15 years. And so have so much respect and appreciation for what our frontline workers are doing. And we used to say, don't call them frontline because it's not like we're at war. But I truly think like they are the frontline workers right now and doing a lot of great work. And when I was in healthcare, I was on the clinical side. So I worked, you know, with patients. And then I went more into administrative side and did what's called process improvement. So I would go into spaces and look at how can we optimize these, you know, the ORs, the exam rooms, the patient processes so that we're saving time, money, energy, and improving outcomes. And I'm hoping all that work is really helping as best as it can right now, because with the system being inundated, we need to optimize as much as we can. So I did that in healthcare for a long time. And it's really looking at a space or a system and saying, how do we eliminate waste? How can we improve the outcomes? And I started, when I left healthcare, I started doing that in people's homes. And I just love it. Like, I love looking at a space and thinking, how can we make this work better or differently? And so it's not just organization, like, oh, because this looks good on Pinterest or whatever it might be, but it's really about how do we make that space function better? I work with a lot of families and, you know, in busy homes. And so I love helping to organize a space so that there's a system, so that there's flow and that it doesn't take so long to get out the door or to, you know, whatever it might be, or to clean the kids, the toys or clothes or whatever. Creating those systems so that we ultimately are feeling better and showing up really the way we want to. And so it's, I would say it's not so much about the space itself, but how does that space impact you? And, you know, also when I was in healthcare, I worked with physicians who were struggling with burnout. And so really understanding the neuroscience of burnout and that how it translates to our homes as well. And so when we look at spaces and people describe feeling overwhelmed, they feel frustrated, they feel anxious, very stressed. So there's a lot of literature and data out there saying it actually does create a stress response in your brain. That's why you feel that way. And so my passion is really helping to create spaces that people don't feel so stressed, because the world is crazy enough, especially right now. The last thing we want is that source of stress to be your closet or whatever it might be. So that's what I love doing, is helping people to create the systems to really preserve like that brain energy and to not feel stressed in their environment. And a lot of people are spending a lot of time in their homes right now. And so calling saying, oh my gosh, I can't look at this anymore. Help me. And so happy to do so.
I love the fact that with so many, like being blessed and honored to have this medium and platform to help showcase people like you, because there's an area of genius in what you do and being able to go into a place and say, well, this would work better if you do this. I was listening to a live show you were on earlier, And one of the things that really stuck me was like the wastefulness of food right now. And it's like setting up your kitchen in a way where you know where things are. You can see the things so you don't go out and buy three things and get home and be like, oh, I had five of these in the pantry. And it's like little things like that we don't think about. Like little simple things like that.
Oh, for sure. I see a lot of people right now, especially, I help a lot of people in their kitchens and their pantries on a normal day or normal time of life, if we can call it normal. And I see so much food go to waste because we just don't know what we have because there's no system in place in those spaces. And I'm like, oh, I can only imagine. Well, I should say, one, we don't know what we have. And then we do the just in case purchases. I'll grab this just in case. Again, that goes back to because we don't know what we have. And so my passion is helping people in their pantry so that within a minute you can look and say, oh, this is what I have. So when you're planning to shop or when you're planning for your meals, you can quickly do a visual inventory of what you have. We're not just over purchasing just in case. And I'm an underbuyer, so it makes me anxious when people buy just in case. So it's interesting in my home because my husband's an overbuyer. He's a just in case kind of guy. So that's why I don't let him shop. But, you know, and so right now I'm like, oh, and so there's fear. I mean, Right. There's a lot of fear. And I deal with that regularly with people because there's a lot of fear of letting go, mm-hmm. a fear of not having something. Mm-hmm. And so we hold on to stuff. And, you know, and then right now there's a lot of fear of what if we can't get this? So I'm going to buy it just in case. And the JICs. So that's a lot of people are coming to me and they're like, what can I do? And I'm like, the number one thing right now is just try to organize your pantry. And like, you know, if you're going to do one thing, like that would be a space so that you can really keep a finger on the pulse of what you have in your house so that we're not overbuying in our own home and taking away from others. And so, and then when this is all said and done and you still have 68 cans of beans, you know, make sure you use them. You know what I mean? Or donate them.
Well, have you always been an underbuyer or is this something you taught yourself?
It's a good question because I read this book called Outer Order, Inner Peace, a lot of what I talk about. And so she was defining it. I was like, oh my gosh, I'm an underbuyer. And she said there's pros and cons to both. And I agree. There's times when I'm like, well, I probably should have bought some more. But I think my dad's always been an underbuyer. So I think that must be where I get it from. I watch a lot of things I do with my kids now. I'm like, oh my gosh, that's from, I got that from my dad. Like, I'm like, you don't need that. You don't need that toy.
I love bags, backpacks, whatever. My sister told me when we were younger, my mom used to, she loves bags too, but we used to carry stuff around in pillowcases. And so I'm like, wow, my bag thing started like way back then. And Jenny's like, God, another bag? I'm like, yeah. So we have a deal now. If I get a new bag, I have to get rid of one.
One in, one out. I love it.
But he has to check with me first because sometimes I like the bag he's getting rid of and I want it because I never was allowed to touch it before.
Oh, that's hilarious. Yeah. Yeah.
Like, well, and I should that's a say, cool bag.
Yeah. You're like, don't get rid of that. It's like my brain is just hardwired to, like I said, look at spaces and be like, how can we optimize this? Like, how can we set it up so it works a little better? Or is it a process? Like, I'm just hardwired for that. And I think when it comes to buying things, I quickly, my brain's just like, woo, you know, like runs it through this ROI. Like, is there a return on buying this? Does it make sense to buy this? Is it adding value? That kind of thing. So
question with that, because this just popped up for me. Are there pros and cons to that? Because we're stuck in a house, extrovert, introvert, and the extrovert wants to do things like rearrange the apartment 10 different times. But when we bought the furniture, I picked stuff for specific places that fit like exactly. So she's like, can we? I'm like, no, it's not going to fit anywhere else. So like we walked in, I saw the room. I was like, yes, boom, boom, boom. But now it's kind of stuck. So there's no room for variety. And Jen's kind of like,
I mean, it would work for you, Jay, but it sounds like for someone who likes to rearrange, maybe not buy it specifically for the space, you know? You know, and I'm also in the spirit right now. Like my kids want to do things. I'm like, that makes no sense. Why are you doing that? But I'm like, you know what? Choose joy right now. If Jenny wants to rearrange it and it doesn't fit, just go with it, Jay. You can always move it back, right? If my kids want to paint the windows, you're like, oh, this is so painful, but I'm going to let you right now because we are stuck in this house.
Okay, I hear you.
So there you go, Jay. You got to be a little flexible.
All right. We'll work on that.
So I'm curious, when you work with different people, you work with people all across the globe, I'm thinking.
US and Canada, yeah.
Okay, US and Canada. So when you work with all these different homes, all these different socioeconomic homes and people and demographics, do you tend to see like one, two, three things that are popping up that are happening in every single home?
Like a pattern?
Like a pattern, yeah.
You know, great question, because I do. I work with people who are living in a one-bedroom apartment to people who live in 18,000 square foot homes. And it all boils down to the same things. And I've been fortunate that they're all just great people that I get to work with. And we're all human and our challenges are very similar despite these socioeconomic differences. And that's based on those things that I've learned has helped me to create like the three-step process that I use with everyone. And that's the first is simplify. Second is create systems. And third is sustain. And simplify is because, you know, people reach out. People aren't like, I think I might get organized next week. They usually reach out and they're like, I can't take it anymore. I'm so overwhelmed. I need help. And it's usually because they're looking at a space and it's bugging them. And the first thing is that there's just too much stuff in that space. And I'm not talking like NASA quarters, even it's just like a drawer. Like there's more stuff than you need in this drawer. And that's what I see. There's too much stuff in the space, stuff that we don't need. And then the second is systems. Then it's, there's no system in place. Like, and that's based on, let's say it's a space. It's, I don't know, say it's your entryway, right? Okay. There's too much stuff in this entryway. Like you don't even use these shoes. You don't wear this coat, that kind of thing. And then thinking about where you're going to place those items. So like, well, where does it make sense to put the sunglasses, to put the coat, to put the shoes, that kind of thing, based on who's using the space too. Do you have adults using it? Do you have kids using it? And so finding homes that really make sense for that space. And that's what people, I think, find it really hard to do, is to get a fresh perspective on like, well, I've always hung my coat here. Well, does that really make sense? And they're like, well, no, it doesn't, because it keeps laying on the floor. So clearly it's not working. And the third is sustain. And that is, life is fluid. So stuff's going to continue to come in. Seasons are going to change in life. And so that's constantly, not constantly, but I constantly encouraging, but you know, consistently looking and being like, do I still need this thing, you know, or whatever that might be, if that's quarterly or if that's just, I'm always looking for things to get rid of. And then also adjusting your systems. So it's like I was saying, like seasons are going to change, clothes are going to change, your activities are going to change. So how do you rearrange that entryway to meet the current needs in your home? And I just want to go back real quick to simplify, talking about, you know, I think, I don't know how to say this, but I just remember like when I did this 18,000 square foot home, I flew to Calgary and organized this home. And it was just interesting because, you know, people are like, oh my gosh, it must have been so much stuff. And I was like, actually, this guy, he had a lot of space, didn't have a lot of stuff. And I loved it, where a lot of people feel like if we have this space, we have to fill it. And that's something really people often like, will clean out a drawer or cabinet. And they're like, oh, well, what should I put in there? I'm like, well, nothing. Nothing needs to go in there. Just because we have space, we feel like we need to fill it. And I think that's what a lot of people have come to know, is that that's what we should do with our space. We should just fill it. We have to put something in there. And a lot of people do that in their homes. And so helping people to understand that.
Yeah, I've grown up believing that. That's one of the main reasons I don't want to move to a bigger place, because I feel you have to fill the spaces. And it's kind of cool to be like, no, you don't.
Yeah. I love what I call, like, you know, you have these set limitations. When people often are like, oh gosh, I'm moving to a smaller house. Like I really need some help figuring out how to make that transition. I'm like, this is beautiful. Like this is going to be great for you, because we can learn to live within that. And you'll almost be like, what are we doing in that space before? Why did we have so much stuff before, is what I hear a lot of people say. And you know, that's even people's closets. I'm like, you only can have what's in there. So that's the nice part, is that when you only have so much space, you can't have any more bags that can fit in that closet, Jay. Or like a bookshelf, you know, like a lot of people like in their office, you know, we go through their books, and it's like, okay, you have this one small bookshelf. All you can have is what fits here. And I think that's what smaller spaces do, is it's like this forced limitation, which sounds so restricting. So I got to come up with better words for it. But I'm like, that's a gift. I think that's such a gift of like, no, you can only have what fits in there. And I think that's easier for people, because it's usually the reverse. It's like, well, I need to put something in here. I'm like, no, you don't. Just let it be.
I especially have lived on both sides of that, because coming out of college, I bought a house and it was a 3-bedroom, 2-bath house, 2-car garage. And I had it all furnished and it was great. And then when I moved to Houston, I had to rent a house. So I went into like a 3-1 house, took all my stuff with me over to Houston. And then Jay taught me that I can live in a downtown area and in a smaller space. So going from that to a 2-bedroom and having to get rid of a lot of stuff, but also merging his stuff with my stuff, it felt so good to get rid of all those things. And I was like, man, I wish I wouldn't have paid to move all this here, but whatever, let it go. And then, you know, as we've stayed in the apartment life, we're in a 2-2 now. And I mean, to be honest, we're like bursting at the seams, which I think is like good and bad, because I feel like I wish we just had just a little bit more space, because I feel like we're just bursting and we constantly are getting rid of things. But it's almost like, I don't know, it keeps us in control. But at the same time, it's like, oh my God, our laundry room, there's 2 bikes crammed in there. And everything is so strategically placed, and every single square foot of space is taken up. like literally.
We should have made this like a virtual, like maybe we can maximize a little space. We can look at it together. And
she's salivating. Figure out how to, guys, she's salivating right now. Figure something out.
We were like, maybe we should like fly Steph out so she can help us out.
until you couldn't, right?
Exactly.
Well, when I come back, because we were supposed to be in Tampa the week of spring break, we were going to go to Tampa, stay in Madeira Beach, and then go to Disney. And then that was changed. So we have Disney credits and we have flights. So we're going to come. So I'll stop by when I come back.
Yay.
Well, you mentioned the moving part, and there are a couple thoughts there that, yeah, I see a lot of people move. And I work with a lot of people in the front end of their move, and then also when they're moving in, and just encouraging people. I see so many people move stuff and they pay to move it, and then they get there and they're like, why did I even move this? Like, and then they end up getting rid of it. So I really try to help people upstream of not moving those things you just don't need. And just because I think about, oh, the cost, and I see people store things and pay movers and pay people to move it in, and then they pay me to unpack it and set it up, and they're like, oh, I don't need that. I'm like, oh my gosh, like this $5 thing costs you like $200, you know? And that's where, like, when I talk about this estate, the last part of, not the last part, but the third part in the process is really about becoming a way of life. And, you know, Jenny, when you said, were you always an overbuyer or underbuyer? And, you know, I'm trying to just think back, because I used to be someone that held on to stuff. Like, I would hold on to like tissue paper and wrapping supplies because I can reuse these. And now I'm in the camp of like just getting rid of stuff. We moved 3 times. My husband and I, this is our third and final house. We're in our forever home. We love it. But I saw that we had moved stuff several times. And I was like, what are we doing with this? And so going through that process has really shifted kind of my lifestyle. So it's not like a one-time event, like feeling organized or getting organized or simplifying, whatever you want to call it, isn't really a one-time event, but it's really a lifestyle. I feel like I'm constantly looking at what's in our home that just is not adding value and is taking up space that we can clear. And I think once you said it felt so good. And it's almost like I was compared to like a food allergy. It's like when you remove dairy or whatever it was that was making you feel like crap. Can I say that?
You could have said the other way too, but.
Okay, no. Yeah. I had to stop. I was like, wait, am I in a first grade classroom or am I?
Where am I? I got kids in school right now. Hold on.
I know. I'm homeschooling right now. So any moment they can pop up. But like you said, once you got rid of all that stuff, you're like, wow, this feels good. I don't want to go back to that. Same thing as like with the food. I don't care how good ice cream tastes. I feel much better without it. But having to go through that experience. And so that's what I hope to help a lot of people to understand is like the stuff, it could be the source of the stress because you look at the stuff, it makes you feel overwhelmed. It triggers that stress response. And it's, I see a lot of people, they're like, well, I keep organizing the space. It's just not working. And I'm like, one thing is there's just too much stuff. Like we could try to build the best system, but if there's too much stuff to maintain or to manage in that space, that just becomes overwhelming and harder to do.
So one of the things that I was thinking as you were going through this is the idea of, okay, I'm going to keep that wrapping paper or I'm going to keep this thing and reuse it. So I have a couple of different thoughts and questions around that. So if you're going to keep it to reuse it so that you're not purchasing something like that again, because I'm thinking I keep bags, you know, when I get a gift, I keep the bag and then I reuse the gift later. Or if I keep certain, like right now we're not drinking alcohol, but I still have all the alcoholic glasses and the little mixers and everything. Like we haven't touched any of that in 2 years. So it's like, do you keep the stuff because you might drink again someday, or you may have people over and you may want to make them a drink, or do you let go of it? What are your thoughts?
Couple thoughts. So I'm going to go right to the, I have to make, because there's 2 points I want to make, but one quickly about like, so the drinking stuff. So you were talking about that you feel like you're busting at the seams and you don't have enough space. I don't know how much stuff you have. I think it kind of boils down to like, well, how much is it? If it's like, oh, I'm holding on to one shot glass, but if you have a cabinet full of entertainment stuff and you don't entertain that often, like you just think about, is that space worth taking up for those things that you may use once? That's where I'd be like, well, if you're going to have a bunch of people over and you're going to have a party and serve alcohol, like, could you just buy some plastic cups for that one-time event versus taking up an entire cabinet? And again, I don't know exactly what the situation is, but versus it taking up that cabinet that you could probably store some things that you use more frequently. You know, like you're paying to store that. That's what I tell people too. I think about like you pay, I don't know, $1,000 a month in rent, and that's taking up a fraction of your space. So over the course of a year, you pay maybe a couple $100 to store those glasses you haven't used in 2 years. That's one way, quickly running it through the ROI. I'm like, what are you paying to store those things that you might use where you could probably just buy $5 plastic cups? I mean, I know it's not best for the environment, but like your health and mental, you know, and your space is worth it. So that's where I look at too. It's like, well, what's the alternative and what would that cost you? And so is it worth taking up your space? You know, and same thing with like the gift wrap. Like I see some people and I'm like, sure, you want to hold down a couple gift bags that you think you're probably going to use. But when people have like two drawerfuls of gift bags, I'm like, you can't possibly even use that many gift bags a year. You know, I listened to this other podcast called The Minimalist. You maybe have heard of them, but think about it as like paying rent. So whatever, there's some like random tool that you bought at Home Depot once that you're like, oh, I don't, you know, for a specific project and you may or may not use it again, but you're going to hold on to it for years and years and you probably won't even be able to find it when you need it. He's like, just think about like, you'll go back to Home Depot and you'll pay him 10 bucks 5 years down the road and think about, you're just paying them rent. Like, here, dude, hold on to this for me for 5 years. And if I need it, I'm going to pay you 10 bucks. Like, you're paying rent. So it's those kind of things where, I mean, I agree. Like, if it's like gift bags or something you use all the time, then you probably hold on to them because you don't want to keep repurchasing them. But if it's like, I may or may not use this and it might cost me a couple bucks a couple years from now, like, that's the kind of thing. And if you're tight on space, those are kind of things I would ask myself, is this worth holding on to? What would it cost me to replace it? Could I use the space differently?
Yeah, as I'm thinking about that, like I like to entertain, but I did that a lot more when I had a house and I have this pipe dream of entertaining. And I do have some things in our cabinets that are for entertaining, you know, like, oh, if you're going to put guac in a thing and you want it to keep cold, it's got the little ice underneath it and it's super cool. But like, I don't think I've ever been able to use it, which I want to use it, but like I've never been able to. But it's like the idea that, oh my God, I don't want to buy it again. And I think that that's something that like I've grown up with that type of a thought, but also I've lived in houses, you know, with my parents that they have the space to have those things and they can go sit in a drawer somewhere and they can pull it out once every 5 years.
Yeah. I helped a client once, we went in her house and, you know, she was just about to have a contractor come in, renovate her kitchen, completely redo things. And I was going through to help her just start going through some stuff. So we opened a cabinet and it was full of cake plates. And we talked about her entertainment stuff. So a lot of people hold on to a lot of entertainment. It's like, you got about 20 cake plates. I was like, how often do you serve 20 cakes at once? And she's like, you know what? I don't even like to make cake and I don't even like to have people over. So why do I even have this? And I was like, oh my God. I was like, well, I just saved you $20,000 from renovating your kitchen. Because she felt like she had no storage space, but she was storing so much stuff she didn't even use. And I think a lot of us do that. Like, yeah, we store things we don't even use. You know, I go to a lot of people's like basements and they're like, oh, I don't have any storage space. I'm like, well, 95% of this is taken up with like holiday decorations that most of them we don't even use. We've just held on to. But also I'm like, you put these on display 1 month out of the year. And I mean, I'll admit, like if I didn't have children, I would be a minimalist. Like literally I put up a tree, I hang up stockings. I'm like, we're good. Where my husband goes and he buys those like penguins that blow up in the front yard, it makes me crazy. You know, I was like, you can get one of those. But, you know, people are, so we're taking a lot of space in our homes of things we don't even use, but right, we're all wired differently. We all hold on to things for different reasons. But I see a lot of people, they say we only use 20% of what we have. And I think I've seen that firsthand and that's the case. So what's the lesson here? If you think you're tight on space, or if you're feeling overwhelmed, that's the first thing I was like, what is taking up your space that really doesn't need to be there? And especially that prime real estate of those spaces that are easily accessible and you're accessing regularly. You know, what's in there that doesn't need to be there?
All right. So let's talk about what's going on right now in the world with this coronavirus and social distancing and staying in your homes. So here's what I'm thinking, a scenario, right? Like, let's say you've got couple parents or whatever, they work during the day, the house stays fairly clean, the kids are at school, and now everybody's at home. Everything is getting thrown all over the place. So what would you suggest that families who maybe had what they felt like was some calmness and now everything is very chaotic in their home? Like you said, your kids are painting on the windows and stuff. Do you have any tips for them to stay calm in this chaos? Or what can they do to work on and organize some of these things?
For sure, yeah. Well, I'm going to be honest, when this first started, so we were on spring break, we did not have any remote learning content or anything. I was like, yeah, we're going to do one project a day because I'm home and I never get to be home and I'm going to tackle all these spaces. Well, then remote learning started and I'm like, okay, bare minimum, how do we keep our heads on straight kind of thing? So I think there's people in like both camps. I will start with the ones that are working from home, doing the remote learning, that kind of stuff. Because what I hear a lot of people, they're like, oh my God, I have less time now than I did before. And I think that's what a lot of people are feeling. And that's where it's like, just like the teachers told us when they sent us the curriculum for remote learning, we're all like, oh my gosh, you gotta be kidding me, right? And they're like, we don't expect to become a teacher, just the bare minimum, like just keep your kids reading, whatever it is. And so I think depending on where you are on that spectrum, right now I'm telling people, and what I'm doing for myself is like, if you just clear one space and making it a habit, like right now, my thing is like, it's always been, but really more so now too, is because we are stuck in this, not stuck, but we are kind of stuck in our homes. And if you have chaos in your environment, it can really trigger and exaggerate what you're feeling inside with anxiety and overwhelm. And we're all wired differently and we all have different thresholds at which we're triggered. And so just remembering, like it doesn't have to be spotless, but just trying your best to create a little calm in this space really does help people as far as their anxiety and what they're feeling. And so I make it a point every night to just clear the kitchen, clear the counter, so that when we wake up, like that's the first place we all go in the morning. And so just having that clear space, it helps me to do my stuff in the morning. Like I say, my journaling, my meditation, whatever it is, and drink my coffee at that counter. And that's usually when my kids come in the morning after they wake up. And so I feel I'm starting on a good note and then I show up better for them. And it's just a clear space. So that's why I tell people, if you feel like you could do nothing else, like you're just holding together best you can, and like just clear your counter or whatever that like one space is that you start your day. That could be your bathroom counter, it could be wherever, but just clearing that space is so therapeutic. And then it creates a habit too. And then for other people who are like, oh, I'm home and I have tons of time because maybe I used to work outside the home and I can't do my job remotely. And that's where I say, like, just pick one space and follow those three steps. So if you want to do a good job, if you're looking at your closet, like go through your stuff first. Because people are always like, oh, I keep organizing it, but it's just not working. Well, you're just rearranging, but really digging in to be like, what doesn't need to be here? Like, where's that 80% of my wardrobe I'm not wearing?
Right. Kind
of thing.
Are you talking about like pulling it all out of your closet, or what are you talking about?
I would say, like, if you can pull it all out, because it helps you to really see what's in there. That's why I tell people, I'm like, they always look at me like I'm crazy. I'm like, oh yeah, no, we're pulling it out. Like, I'm not saying, no offense, Ricardo, but she does it where the TV show, they have it piled on the bed. And I was like, well, that's just overwhelming. Like, no, like, but pulling it out helps you. Let's say your closet, like pulling it out and being like, okay, all my black long sleeve shirts here, all my white long sleeve shirts here, because it helps you to truly get a sense too. You're like, oh my gosh, people always say, I didn't realize I had 8 of those. And you only wear like one of them. So it just helps you to get a true sense doing the inventory of really what you have for your pantry to see what you really do already have, like 8 cans of tomatoes. So you don't need to buy any more, because how many cans of tomatoes can you eat in a week, you know? So I would say, like, this is a great time to really be thorough. Pull it all out, inventory what you have, and really ask the question of, do I really wear this? Which I know is hard for some people to do, because they're like, well, I might, just in case, what if I'm a friend over?
I'm kind of like that sometimes.
Yes, exactly. So, yeah. And that's where maybe you could pull those, you know, just in case things, maybe put them to the side and say, okay, see if you use them. Like, pull those things, be like, these are things I love to wear, these are things I love to use. Putting those in a certain space, maybe putting those just in case to the side. And then in a few weeks or a few months, whatever it is, and you're like, oh, I still haven't touched those. You know, that's one way just to see.
Great idea.
That's more of an objective way to say, oh, weird, I haven't touched this. So, but usually I'm not so kind. I just look at people and I'm like, no, we're getting rid of it.
But sometimes we need that outside person to be like, whoa.
Yeah. I always ask my clients, because people are like, I can do this on my own, but I'll just be honest, people aren't as effective than having someone there to hold them accountable. And I always ask my client, I was like, okay, because I'm a people pleaser. It's weird when you're in people's faces and you're like, I'm not judging you, I'm just trying to help you. But that's what they tell me. They're like, no, tell it to me straight. I need you to tell me. I'm like, okay. But I always kind of ask them kind of where they're at. Like, if they want the kid gloves or they want me to like wear, have the velvet hammer, you know?
I had like 10 shirts. Some were brand new and I was like, I've never worn these, had them for about 4 or 5 months. So I took them all out and we went to Dallas for Thanksgiving, and I gave 5 to my brother-in-law and I gave the other 5 to my cousin-in-law or whatever he would be. And they were like, yo, these are like brand new. I was like, I'm not going to wear them. So Merry Christmas. You're welcome.
Yeah, that's awesome. I love secondhand clothes. I get them all the time. So I think that helps people sometimes if they have a place that they can give them away or something like that. I think that helps because people often like, oh my God, I spent money on this. And for some people, it's like, I don't want to just give it away. So find somewhere to give it. I had one of my clients who's an NFL player from Jamaica, and he, you know, fortunate enough that he could afford to ship this stuff, but he bought, I mean, the boxes and boxes of stuff, and he just shipped it back to where he lived in Jamaica to all his family and just his village and stuff like that. And so finding a way to get that stuff, give it to a friend or whatever it is. In my book, I talk about the dopamine release that I used to get from shopping or finding a good deal. Well, look, I got this sweater. Like literally, I would go shopping. And so maybe it wasn't always an underbuyer. It was always a bargain shopper, I guess.
Bargain shopper. My family, before you finish the story, my family used to make fun of me because I'd be like, it's only a dollar. And they're like, yeah, but you bought 15. It's only a dollar. So now that's $15. And I was like, oh.
Yeah. And then, you know, when you think about, I'll finish one thing. So dopamine, like, where I would go and I literally would go straight to the back of the store, straight to the shop, like the bargain rack in the Gap, and be like, oh, what can I find? Can I find a good deal? I didn't need it. It just, I wanted that deal. And then I would find those things in my closet still with the tags. I put it on. I was like, this looks awful. You know, like, this is just awful. Like I bought it because it was $5. Like I don't even like the cut, that kind of thing. But now I get the dopamine release of getting rid of stuff. And so you think about also when you bring these things into your home that then there's just the upkeep of things. So there's things that we take on that we're going to use, but there's the upkeep and there's costs and the energy associated with that. If people bring these things in and it was only a dollar, but then they struggle to let go of it because, well, I paid money for this. So it's, again, it was only a dollar, but there's just such a greater cost that, you know, it was far more than the dollar what it's costing you. And that's why when I talk about sustain, it's not just about creating or purging or adjusting your systems. But I talk a lot about being intentional about what you bring back in, because that comes the responsibility of making the decision of what you're going to do with it. And you have to go through it and then you struggle to let go of it. And so that's why I'm like, just don't bring it in. Like really changing those habits of, I don't care if it's a deal. I'm actually losing money the second I bring it into my home.
All the mental stuff that goes in with organizing, not organizing, like these triggers, the bargain buys, and then finding a place for the stuff and not wearing the stuff and getting rid of the stuff and holding on to the stuff. It's like, oh my gosh, there's just, I never really thought of it from this point of view.
Oh yeah. I talk about, in addition to working with people one-on-one, I also have online courses and DIY kits. And I actually talk about, there's one about like papers. And this is back, going back to my healthcare training where we would have to process map things out. So every step of the process, and you'd have to determine, is this adding value or not adding value? And so I even talk about like with a piece of mail that comes into your house and mapping it out the whole way where you're like, you bring it in, you set it on the counter, then you move it to the desk, then you move it here, then you move it there. And then ultimately you just end up throwing it away. But just looking at the journey of an item in your home or life, obviously most people are not going to sit and think about it, but it's just an example. If you really map it out, the journey of this thing in your house, like if I think about that $4.95 shirt, I got an Old Navy or the Gap, and the journey of it, ultimately there's at no point is it above the adding value line. It's all just below and it's leaving my house. So I'm like, that's where it's like, you're actually in the negative by bringing these things into your home and life. And I think our life is just busy enough. You know, our brains are not equipped for today's world. And so it's just one other way that we can just reduce some of that chaos. Like this stuff, it does add layer of chaos into our homes and lives. And it's like, is that worth taking away from, you know, the energy that I want to show up? You know, this might be actually a segue that I know, like health and wellness, a healthy lifestyle is just a big part of what you do. And I love that. And that's something I've seen in a lot of my clients is that they were like, come organize my house because I want to start running. They didn't even know that it'd be a byproduct. But with behavior change, which you guys are so familiar with, I'm sure, but any of the behavior change theories or models, like at the base of it, like environment's one of the biggest things. And so that's what I've loved to see. Like I'm an exercise physiologist as trained. And so I love seeing that where people are like, oh my gosh, a client, she just started running now because she was feeling better about her space and she wasn't so drained and had more energy and to like invest in herself. And she wasn't taking so much time to make the kids' lunches and to do the laundry and a meal plan. And in turn, she was investing this in herself. And I think, you know, for people, it's like, if you're looking to make a change, I think the first thing you can do is a very simple thing is like, how can you change your environment to help support that? And like people don't realize the impact it has. And that's something I just love to see is how people have taken charge of their health, how they've changed their eating habits, how they've invested in their business, in their marriages, as parents, just as a result of clearing their space, because literally their mind is shifting because there's not that trigger anymore.
And hopefully we're moving towards a point where it's a shift and it's awakening with society and people in general, because all these things really tie together. It's not like, I mean, being from the fitness industry and being in and out of gyms and seeing all that, you know, people would come in thinking that if they looked a certain way, it would fix the relationships. It would fix the stress. It would fix all these other things. And it was like, no, looking good is not the answer. You don't do this because you want to look good. You're doing this because you're feeling a certain way. And if you look a certain way, that's just putting a Band-Aid on everything else that goes on. You have to fix, like you said, your environment, because there's triggers there. And then once you fix that, you have to fix the way that you look and see things, because there's triggers there. And then you will start to move and eat and feel better, because there's certain triggers and certain associations we have with food. A lot of my old clients, their thing is like, I need to eat cleaner. And it's like diving in to, you know, eating clean, not eating clean. It's not a right or wrong thing. It's like, what are the triggers that make you feel like you're making bad decisions? I'm not saying you are making bad decisions, but what are your triggers that's making you think you have these? And some of them like go all the way back to being a child. You know, my mom or my dad said I couldn't leave the table until I had a happy plate. So you're telling this child, who already probably has a vivid imagination, that this animate object is going to be sad if you don't clean the plate, which you're starting a traumatic experience. You're creating an anchor right there with an attachment with food. So now you're growing up and you're like, okay, I have to eat everything on my plate or something's not going to be happy. It might not be the plate, but my spouse might not be happy. If I'm eating with a client, the client isn't going to be happy because I didn't finish things. And all these things that we don't think about that are triggers to why we don't, quote unquote, eat clean or healthier.
You know, I think it's a really good point you bring up, that I, when helping people in their homes where we're going through stuff and they're like, well, my mom gave me this, or my aunt sent me this, or my whatever husband, my kid, whatever it is, like they're justifying why they're keeping something in a box in the basement. I was like, oh, so it's that special to you? So you're going to cram it in a box and throw it in the basement? Because I'm like, oh, that's nice. Let's put it on the mantle. They're like, I'm not going to put it on the mantle. I'm like, if it's that important, either display it or get rid of it, you know? And like the memory's not in the stuff. Like the memory is still there. And so the belief of like, my mom held on to everything or whatever it is, like I need to hold on to something. Like I'm a bad daughter if I get rid of grandma's china that's been stored for 6 months in the, or 6 years in the basement or whatever it is. But helping people to break down, yeah, like kind of those old maps or those broken beliefs. And yeah, I see that a lot. Just we hold on to things or we eat certain things because of things we've heard and how we were brought up or messages we've heard of that kind of thing, or like those old maps. And so, yeah, there's just a lot of similarity there. You know, our space, the other big things I see. So it's like health and wellness. Like, again, when your brain shifts, where you're not feeling so triggered or stressed, you're waking up that smart part of your brain. And so you're more likely, like I'm watching this guy run on the trail right now. I love it. This is my little office. I see everyone exercising on the trail. It makes me happy. And it motivates me too. You know, but it's your ability and just your capacity and mental capacity to focus on yourself. And so if you want to start walking or running, you know, having just that brain space for that. There's studies about how your kitchen is set up and your eating habits, clear space versus the clutter space. I always encourage people, I'm like, just clear your counters. Try your best not to store a bunch of stuff, especially food on your counters, especially cookie jars. And then relationships, that's a big one. You guys even just talking here about how Jenny likes to hold on to things or Jay does or whatever it is, like we're all wired differently. So I just see a lot of relationships. I mean, I'm like, oh my gosh, I need to be like, get some training as a therapist because I'm often in these situations between couples and you're like, I don't want to step on any toes here, but I want to help you. You know, relationships and then finances we talked about, just the stuff we buy or things we hold on to or things we buy just in case. And then time management, that when you start to clear your space, not only do you save time because you're not searching for things, but just again, how your brain shifts, you're just more effective with your time. Like your brain can function differently when your space does not feel so chaotic or cluttered. And so it seeps into so many other aspects of our life. Just like you're saying, like if you're taking charge of your health, it's amazing when you see how it just kind of this ripple effect into other aspects. So it's not just affecting that one space.
Oh my God, I am so motivated. I cannot wait to go get rid of some stuff. I can't wait to go like just clean out all the spaces. And I bet you are feeling the same way. So Stephanie, like how the heck can we get in contact with you, or what can you help us, since right now, especially you can't come in person. So what kind of services are you offering now? And then of course, once this all clears, what are some of the normal services that you offer? Like, how can you help us? I'm ready to go get rid of some stuff.
Yes. Well, I'm so excited, Jenny. Can't wait to hear what you do with all your shot glasses. yes. Well, yeah. And I will say, if you're at home right now and you're feeling motivated like Jenny, so just again, following that steps, be like, just look and be like, okay, what is in here that does not need to be in here? And that doesn't necessarily mean like you need to get rid of everything, but just be like, does this really need to be here? do I use this in this space? Or like, if it's a, you know, your drawer in your kitchen and you've got, I don't know, say a hammer that you never use, but like, does this really need to be here? Because this space could be used for something else that whatever that I grab daily. So really going through your space, then thinking about how do I create a home for things and where does it make sense to put that? People always say, well, where should I put it? Well, where do you use it? If you don't use it that frequently, then tuck it away. But if it's frequent, put it where you use it so it's not landing on the counter waiting to be put away. So just following those two steps of your home. But I have tons of free resources on my website, which is lifemadesimpleathome.com. And I also, at this time, which I've done previously, so I have clients around the country and the world that I do support virtually. And so I do video chats just like this. And, you know, video chats helping someone. I spent 5 hours on a chat last week helping someone set up their kitchen after renovation. And so virtual services. And then I have all my online kits, which are like DIY kits to organize any space in your house. And that's also on the website. But or just follow me for fun ideas and tips. It's Life Made Simple at Home, both on Facebook and Instagram.
Yeah, we'll make sure we have all that in the show notes for you as well, so you know exactly how to get in touch with Stephanie. But man, I'm serious. Our day might be totally reorganized, meaning we are going to reprioritize the things we were going to do.
And we've had moments where talking about space and like our office is the kitchen table where we eat at, where we have our podcast studio, where we shoot our Facebook lives and, you know, all this stuff. So it's like, So
there's always stuff on it.
There's always stuff. But, you know, we have moves where we're like, yo, we just got to go through. Let's just get rid of stuff. Like, it wasn't a joke. But yeah, I got rid of like 30 cords, 20 or 30 cords last week. And I'm like, because if you buy a new electronic, they're going to give you a cord. So it's not like you're missing cords. Apple gives you at least two cords now. So it's like, I don't need all these cords. We can get rid of them.
Jay, that's a great example. So if you're like, hi, I want to do something, I don't know what to do. I guarantee you have a box of cords in your house and you can go through them or go through your drawer, gather the cords. That would be a great, and that's why I tell people, start small. If you're feeling overwhelmed, which most people are, just start small. And just from that small movement of like cleaning out a small drawer or your box of cords, whatever it is, like literally it will shift your brain where you're like, oh my God, this feels so good. I can do more. It's kind of like, you know, if you're going to start running, like you go for a walk, you start small and you're like, actually, hey, I can do this. Okay, I'm going to walk further tomorrow kind of thing. So yeah, just starting small and start with the cords, if nothing else.
Oh, thanks, Stephanie. I mean, this has been awesome. There's been so many gems throughout this whole conversation. And we know that you are getting all kinds of amazing things that you can implement into your life. And Stephanie has been a huge resource here. Like I said, Jay and I are going to get to work this afternoon. We want to hear, Stephanie wants to hear what you've been doing. So make sure you reach out and connect with her at lifemadesimpleathome.com, right?
Yeah, that's correct.
Yes, perfect. So, all right, guys. Thanks for joining, Steph. Thanks for being here.
Thank you so much, guys. It was so great chatting with you.
Yay. Mahalo.
You can subscribe to the Holistic Life podcast from your favorite streaming platform. And don't forget to check out 2jholla.com to stay in the know as an official 2JH insider. Mahalo for tuning in. And until next time, that's our show.